Hi, I'm Suresh Venkat. You're watching a roundtable on managing human capital in the digital world. Joining me are Adesh Goyal, Global Head of Human Resources at Tata Communications, R. Chandrasekharan, Executive Vice Chairman, Cognizant, Pramod Basin, Vice Chairman, Genpact, and Chairman, the Skills Academy. Gentlemen, let me start with the first question, and the first question goes to you, Adesh. The single biggest challenge in managing the millennial generation, that is people born 1980s onwards.
Yeah.
None of the people on this panel, unfortunately.
Absolutely, including me. You know, the biggest challenge is really the paradigm that they're operating from and the paradigm we as managers are operating from. And that's where this fight happens, you know, what's right, what is wrong. For example, the millennials are looking at not work-life balance. You know, we are looking at work-life balance. What they're looking at is how do you really blend work and life? They're willing to do some work when they're at home or doing some social stuff. And they want the flexibility to do some personal stuff while they're at work. And many managers don't accept that. So that's really the big challenge, you know. Their aspirations, expectations are very different. They want everything as they want, open, transparent, available at any time, at any place. Whereas we are looking at doing it in a very organized way. So
the challenge of managing millennials, if I were to summarize it, is the challenge of training managers to manage the millennials and understand.
Exactly.
It's not
exactly.
The millennials themselves.
Exactly.
Pramod Basin, second question for you. CEOs and HR heads across India keep talking about the so-called talent crisis. How bad is it?
Yes. The talent crisis is reasonably bad because the number of people we can actually hire from the graduates coming out is so abysmally low. And our education system is still, I'm afraid, abysmally poor.
In spite of our much-wanted demographic dividend that we keep talking about.
But the fact is that we have enough people. And therefore, I am always looking at the IT and BPO companies as an example where these companies have set up massive training programs to upskill these people. So to be honest, and putting it a different way, I don't think we see... Does it cost us more money? Does it take us more time? Yes. Is it a massive challenge that we can't solve? No. We'll solve for it every day.
Are we solving it?
Oh, yes. I think we're solving it every day. I think every company here, certainly represented here, will have put in a massive effort into training their own people, upskilling them, providing them continuing education, etc. The problem arises in the service providers, where people or companies who haven't provided that kind of training to their employees actually suffer because the quality of service in India generally is quite poor because the people coming through college just have no clue as to what that involves or how to work in a business, etc. That's where we hurt. Within our companies, I think we have challenges, but we are solving them.
Richard Chandrasekharan, your employees are looking for, and I'm just going to list a few attributes, freedom, fairness, challenging work, and monetary incentives. This is what your millennial employees are looking for.
Right.
What are you looking for from them?
Actually, you know, we want them to be productive. We want them to be engaged in whatever they are doing. We want them to be very passionate in whatever they are working on. And for all these things to happen, we need to really provide a very conducive environment. You know, if we try to give them the environment that we all grew up with, mm-hmm. That's not going to stick with them, right?
So what is going to stick with them?
So, you know, really, when we grew up, you know, our office infrastructure was better than the infrastructure we had at home,
yeah.
Right? But today it's completely different. The home infrastructure is much more engaging than what we have in the office. So how do we really provide an infrastructure for them to be engaged in whatever they do? And then we all grew in a very singular track. You know, if you're in the office, we used to do work, right? And if you go home, then we used to do whatever we needed to do
but
personally.
That paradigm is gone.
But nowadays, you know, there's no job. You know, job is part of an activity that you perform in a day, right? Mm-hmm. Among so many activities that people do, right? Which is personal, official, anything social. So we need to really provide an environment where people are at have their freedom to do what they want to do during the day, but make them accountable. I think every person...
So freedom and accountability, the counterbalance between those two would be the big challenge
for
you?
We have to make the millennial generation realize that freedom is not free, right? Freedom comes with certain accountability.
Okay.
I think they are realistic. You know, they all realize, they all studied, you know, they may have freaked out in the college, but then they all know that they had to study and they graduate. So they realize their responsibility and you give them the freedom, they will perform better. So you need to provide them the right environment, the freedom, and make them accountable.
Mr. Goyal, any large company has inherent bureaucracy and red tape. You need it to actually run the company. A small startup is exciting, a lot like college life, where you, in the words of Mr. Chandrasekhar, you can freak out, have a good time. It's a bohemian atmosphere. But large companies tend to be formal and bureaucratic. How do you make sure that you have a fun generation who wants to have fun and work in a startup-like environment, make them work in large organizations, and give them that sense of belonging and context?
Yeah. You know, this is always a very difficult thing. And the way I know many companies are doing, including ours, is somebody needs to become a champion for this. You know, you can't ask 2,000 managers to do this, this, this. You simply encourage all the employees to say, hey, we realize this is the way you want to work, this is a platform, and just go and do it. You know, for example, we do a large number of projects which are cross-functional. And anybody can sign up for any project that they want as long as the project manager is willing to hire them. And this is in addition to what their business as usual job is. And we said that, hey, you don't need anybody's permission. Now, if your manager troubles you too much, talk to somebody. So you actually, the change has to come from the bottom. And you have to just tell them that, you know, within a loose leash, this is how you can operate. Okay. And just allow it to happen more and more. And over a period of time, it just becomes a norm, and then managers really have no choice but to say, hey, it still works, because ultimately...
And they're able to achieve productivity even with this sort of loose structure, if I may call it.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Okay. Mr. Basin, I'm quoting from an ASSOCHAM survey in 2012 that said 62% of all employees felt they had a boss who humiliated, insulted, or isolated them. 62% of Indian employees.
Hmm.
And this I'm quoting an ASSOCHAM survey.
Hmm.
We talked about the challenge of middle managers and training them.
Yes.
Do we have a middle managerial crisis in India?
I wouldn't call it a crisis, but we certainly have a middle management problem.
Okay.
And it results primarily from the fact that, again, I go back to our education system, it actually doesn't really teach people to manage very well. So when they enter the workforce and then get promoted to run people.
It teaches you to work, but not to manage other people.
It teaches you activity. Yeah. You know, it doesn't teach you all the other softer aspects, which are actually far more important when you take on a managerial role. So the ability to communicate, to influence, to work as a team are all new inputs. And if your company doesn't have a strong culture and values, these are things that people have to recreate and invent for themselves. And inevitably, given the environment we live in, and I was going to make that point about the millennium generation's challenges, our environment is very much hierarchical.
Okay.
That's where people have come from. They automatically fall back on that same hierarchy.
Onto the architecture of the old economy architecture.
And what I think that this generation actually wants is, to paraphrase what you were saying, this generation wants freedom, and they want to be entrepreneurs within companies. And companies for years have throttled entrepreneurship and innovation. And I think we just have been far too cautious. We just have not jumped out of the box and say, you know, how do we unleash these people truly? Because for us, this is a massive opportunity. We have some of the brightest people in the world working for us.
Right.
And if you ask me, do we use them well? My answer is no. I think we use their potential on a scale of 1 to 10. Maybe we're at 2 or 3. No more than that.
So if you really look at it, you know, today's successful organization, you would find the empowered culture. So empowerment is very key. You know, you need to provide individuals the space that they need to be successful. You need to allow them to experiment and figure it out for themselves. Provide them the broad guidelines,
yeah,
and empower them and make
innovate.
Them accountable for results.
You know, yeah.
They will innovate, they will come out with best practices, and you will get the best out of the individuals.
You, Cognizant had a dramatically young CEO. He became CEO at 29, Francisco, 29, 30.
30.
Most companies talk about young people, most companies talk about the millennial generation, most companies say that our employees are our biggest asset. But they're all governed by boards of men in their 50s and 60s.
Lip service.
Why don't we see a single company in India where a 25-year-old person is appointed to the board, and we say, here's a board member, he or she is 25 years old, and he or she will guide us on our policy for millennials?
No, I think it's only a matter of time. It'll definitely happen.
Okay.
You know, I see a lot of bright kids coming out of college. They all want to be on their own, right? When these companies take form and shape, you know, you're going to see much more vibrant, youthful entrepreneurs who is going to be spreading their wings across the globe, and they're going to play a very important role in future boards of the organization.
But
so it's only a matter of time, because before you change, see some change.
But the old guard in India has a hard time letting go.
Right. Yeah.
We should also accept that. It applies to politics, companies,
Right. My next question is for Adesh Goel. So one way of bringing more young people into organizational strategy is to put them on the board.
Yeah.
But that's not the only way, is it? Yeah. There are other ways.
Yeah. I think that's very well said, Suresh. I think crowdsourcing is really a big thing.
Okay.
Within the company, you know, for example, take a company like ours, and it's representative of many modern companies where everybody's connected online, right? So we recently launched a program called Shape the Future, which is really defining the strategy of the company 5 to 10 years from now, what the vision is. And we launched this program globally. We have employees in 30 countries of as many nationalities. And we ask them to work in teams or individually and, you know, give their ideas.
Actually help shape corporate strategy.
Absolutely.
And are their ideas taken seriously?
Yeah,
and do they sense that their ideas are
absolutely
taken seriously?
So we received 108 ideas, which involving about 1,000 employees. And we have now shortlisted those 25 ideas, and they're going to now present it to a small panel. And the next step is going to be that we'll identify at least 4 or 5 ideas where we have said that we're going to commit at least $2 million to take it further.
And I can see some resonance in the way the Aam Aadmi Party, for instance, is crowdsourcing ideas from its constituents and from its party workers as well as its electorate.
Yeah, absolutely.
Saying that we'll use the mobile phone as a tool for informal referendums.
Absolutely. And by the way, it works in many other ways. You know, today we have a portfolio of more than 1,000 e-learning programs. And our platform allows people to take that training on the move from wherever they are at the time that they want to do. Similarly, we have something called as Talent Cloud, which means hiring through the employees and hiring the employees.
Through a referral method.
Yeah,
buddy
so to a referral method, and also allowing people to move to any job within the company. So we had advertised 100% of our jobs online, and every employee is eligible to apply for every job. And we interview them the way they interviewed from outside. And today, you know, we do about 55% of our hiring through the Talent Cloud. So people want to do things at the time that they want to do it in the way they want. We just have to create the platform.
Right. Adesh, my final question to you. You head the human resources for globally for Tata Communications. Is HR a dying profession? Will HR now become part of every other team and you won't have an HR department in the future anymore?
Yeah. See, I see HR department as a facilitator and a guide.
Okay.
Which means you have to create systems, policies, practices, tools, culture, and then enable and support other people to do that. Okay. For example, you would always do hiring. The way you used to do hiring 20 years ago was putting a large ad in the newspaper and you get so many applications. Today that hiring is done using some other thing, but HR is still doing it.
Okay.
Rather than saying who is going to do what and how do you promote somebody, what we are working on is a career portal, which works like Google Maps, where each employee can decide from wherever they are, wherever they go. We are working on saying what are the different paths that are available for you to go, what training programs you need to do. These are the people who actually took that path earlier. They are available to you online for helping you. So the nature of what we do is changing. But I think every single function is going to exist.
It's going
it
to exist.
It has to exist in a different form.
As the organization changes, the HR departments and their philosophy has to change concomitantly with the
Absolutely.
Organization.
If within my career, things have moved from personnel management. I actually studied that course, you know, it was not
personnel
HR.
Personnel management, that's an outdated term
right?
now. But
now it is HR, right, and it's the HR on the cloud. Our HR system is on the cloud.
Okay.
It's not on-premise. So I think every function will exist, but it needs to become more and more an enabling and a catalytic function rather than a controlling function.
So that's the future of HR, it's the future of strategy and the future of the Indian IT corporation in the eyes of the millennial generation. Gentlemen, thank you very much for being part of this discussion. Thank you for watching.